Hello. Okay, let's
get the party started. And we'll start with relative silence tonight. Thank you for tuning in. I'm Gary Lucas. And a pleasure to be here with you, to play for you this evening. And I'm gonna start from sounds and show you how I build up some of these little soundscape thingies I do.
Let's see.
Start with a nice tempo. It's a nice brisk tempo, right? Son, you spit on those under 21, but now your blue thighs are gone. You better say so long, a little hey, bye, bye, bye. You paint your wallpapers green, you want to make love to the sea. Your European son is gone, you better say so long, without drifting goodbye. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
CBS Records. Let me show you what we do around here. Okay, well, that was fun. For me, I hope for you, I don't know what it sounds like out there, but I have an iPhone 13 that just arrived over there in the box that I haven't yet unpacked because I've been so busy, like all of us here, you know, trying to survive in a ruthless economy. Yeah, wearing a lot of hats. And I don't know, I just finished a new article for culturecatch.com. That's one word, C-U-L-T-U-R-E-C-A-T-C-H. One word, Culture Catch. Now, this is my friend Mark Petrarca, one of the first of the very nice people I encountered in New York City all those years ago. And Mark was a former mailbox, no, mailroom employee of William Morris Agency, and he's done a lot since then. He used to be an editor at Spin magazine for a while, as I recall. And published me, back in the day in one of their last iterations. And he's a great guy, great journalist, and a really fine musician, and now editor. But Culture Catch has been around for a while, and you can see clips of him interviewing such luminaries as Gore Vidal, before he passed away, and sundry other very interesting celebrity intellectuals, slash David Lynch, among them. He brought me out to San Francisco, it must be about 10, 15 years ago, to do an event he was sponsoring, and he had David Lynch on a satellite hookup. We spoke together, and I played at the Great American Music Hall that night for an event that he put on. And it's a really, really great choreographer that I met out there who is named Tiffany Barber. So Tiffany, if you're watching or listening, hello. And she had an amazing troupe of, I don't know, fembots. I can't really describe it any other way, but very, very entertaining visually. Otherwise, and well, anyway, so Culture Catch, you gotta check it out because I've got 5 or 6 pieces up there that I've written in the last couple of weeks. I mean, he's nothing if not generous in allowing me space to wax enthusiastically or otherwise, mainly enthusiastically, about stuff I like and I want to share with you, because that's one of my greatest joys, is trying to turn people onto stuff like music that I like, that you might, you know, feel worth your while to check out. Though I do notice whenever I post anything on wonderful Facebook that is not automatically familiar to everybody, either in the Beefheart or Jeff Buckley arena, pretty much it gets very few interested parties. I don't often say much in the captions, but trust me, anything I put up there, I think, is well worth your attention, even in an ironic sense, because I do have a very, very well-developed sense of irony. It's kind of, it runs with the territory, it goes with the territory, along with a lot of other traits, of being Jewish. And speaking of which, I was at a very, very cool event tonight at the Neue Gallery, which, for those of you who don't know, in New York, you should visit this place. It's on 86th Street, right off the Central Park West, over there. And it is run by Ronald Lauder, who is one of the most notable Jewish philanthropists in the world, and has done so much to try and honor and restore a lot of Jewish heritage that was threatened to be expunged in the world, in the Second World War, for instance. But this is an old story, except for the 60% of American youth populace who've never heard of the Holocaust, which is a frightening statistic, is it not? Yeah, anyway, so he was feting David de Jong, who is a young Dutch journalist who worked for Bloomberg News, who's written a searing account of German white shoe industrial firm complicity in the Second World War effort by which Jewish suffering en masse was monetized and profiteered on, which is not a new story to people who are students of this period, but he's amassed so much documentary evidence, and he wrote it in such a vivid style that the advance reviews have been phenomenal. And so I picked up a copy. I plunked down my $28 or thereabouts. And he was kind enough to autograph it. So I'm really looking forward to reading this. And it's called Nazi Billionaires, which is a provocative title, is it not? Anyway, I think that actually it ties in a little bit with the focus right now on historicism and trying to make sense of the current situation with Ukraine and Russia. And yeah, I mean, I find it as stomach-churning as you all to tune in. I guess our preferred channel is BBC World. They seem to have the best reportage on the ground right now, and as you know, it's horrifying and just, it's unbelievable that it's happening again. But history does repeat itself, as they say. Another book I can recommend is Bloodlands by the historian Timothy Snyder, Europe Between Hitler and Stalin, which goes into somewhat excruciating detail about a history of, among other things, pogroms against Jewish people, going back to the 19th century in Ukraine area, you know, and how then to account for the phenomenon of a heroic Jewish leader like Zelensky. Well, you know, all that is to say, I think that there was a realization that they had to modernize and actually make a feint towards the West and NATO, and hence you get the current situation. Which, who knows how it's going to play out? I don't, but anyway, while it's happening, I'm here to entertain you as best I can. So anyway, thank you for tuning in. It's almost 11 o'clock and time for a full hour of Jerry Seinfeld, which Caroline and I find to be a tonic. Then maybe I'll tune into BBC World at midnight for an update. But I can only really watch it once a day in the cycle. And they do repeat themselves. I mean, they have to. But I recommend their coverage. Also, as you know, CNN, MSNBC, and once in a while turn on Fox News just to know how they're covering it in their own peculiar way. I don't even want to go into my disgust of how many of their pundits have tried to twist this and seem to be rooting for Russia in this moment, which is not merely inexplicable, but actually disgusting to me. But okay, that's just me. And you can agree to disagree on that. It's a free country, is it not?
All right, thanks for tuning in. And I guess I'll see you on, what day is it today? Okay, Thursday at about the same time. Okay, love you guys. Oops. Over and out.